I'm Jackson Holtham. I'm 24 years old. I'm a snowboard coach from Adelaide, South Australia. I'm a performance coach and an amateur ultra marathoner. My first recorded run on Strava was on the 15th of April. It was a 5K at about a 6 minute pace. And I just remember being like absolutely shattered by this run, but something just sort of happened. Like I got a little bit hooked on it. And slowly through the week, like I started running a little bit more and running a little bit more. And then typically with my personality is I get a little bit hooked on things. And I think the reason why I took to running so much was that there was nowhere to hide in it. If there's something going on that you need to think about it, it comes out. And that's what hooked me to running. It made me realize all the things I was doing great and the things that I wasn't so great at. And I had to work on them. Once I started running, this thing kept coming up when I was running that, well, what's the hardest thing I could do that would require me working on myself to become a bit of a high performance athlete? And how can I go about doing that? And then that's when ultras sort of came to the forefront. To me, the thought of running 50K, 75K, 100K, 100 miles seemed like this almost unachievable task, but I knew that if I could refine myself in the way that I went about things, I could treat myself as a bit of an athlete and then put myself through those steps and I can become a high performance athlete, and then that increases the level of my work. That's why I picked ultras.
It's been good. I don't like the week coming in where you have to hammer a lot of carbs, and I don't like the way it makes me feel as much. I feel a bit lazy because you're not doing as much running. You're not eating the same maybe as you were in your training weeks, sort of slamming a bit more carbs. I don't like that feeling, but I feel like I'm nailing it in terms of what needs to be done to make tomorrow as good as possible.
What do you reckon? Tracker? Some maps?
So do you have to orienteer as well?
Bib number, because I'm a boss now.
No, my first ever ultra, I ran with a really good friend of mine, Sharpie. We ran 75K from Cape Jervis to Victor with almost no planning. I planned all my nutrition, but basically he was going to follow me on a bike and I was going to run. And from there, I sort of learned that the next ultra I was going to have to do, I had to have a bit of a team that was going to help me plan. And the first person that sort of taken the big time role in that team is my dad. He's sort of become a bit of the manager and has taught me how to think about these things a little bit more clearly and plan all aspects, not just how I'm going to run it and what I'm going to eat.
Track sort of is not quite the same, but this bit here is just out and back. We say, you're going to take that long to get there. They're going to take that long to get there.
My mum, who's, I guess, like my rock, you know, she's always there. She's the one who allows me to sort of do the things that I do. And like all mothers, she's the caring one and the messiah. I have my little brother, Tommy, who's coming over from WA, but he's gonna run some parts of the run with me. He's a unique character in himself, but he's my buddy runner. I'm gonna have one of my best friends, H. He's sort of crewing it. He's gonna drive my filmer around, Alex. You know, we've been friends for so long that he's going to be a great face to see at aid stations, and so that's my crew. And I love the wet. I love the rain. I love running in the rain. As long as it doesn't rain like late at night, then we're sweet. But this is mint, man. This is the best. This is the best conditions. I mean, people might not profit as much. Might not be prepared about the rain. You know, a few people might not enjoy it, but it's definitely my thing. We'll see what happens.
Check one,
they'll
let you know.
Thanks so much.
I think it'll be alright. Just pace. At the end of the day, I think it's all pace. So if he can hold it, then he's sweet. He just doesn't want to blow up the first hill, I think. I think he's third.
Oh, that green. It's in the leading pack.
Broken away from the peloton, the big dog.
He's up here, is he?
Who's the other two?
Here we are.
This first hill was going to be huge. I hope he doesn't work too hard up. Because, like, you can blow up. It's gonna make everything else so much harder than this.
There's some people that just check one out.
This high, this one. This one.
It's nice out there, hey. Nice temperature. Pretty sweet.
That one.
Perfect temperature, man. Is my tracker working?
Yep.
I kept moving it around, I had no idea. Was it working at the start?
Yep.
Got the hill pretty quick.
Little prickles.
I was like, I felt like I was moving really
slow. You're burning up the hill.
Really slow and really controlled.
Thanks, guys.
Made some friends. That's Jeffy.
Yeah.
He's a savage.
The solution would be leaving it unlocked.
Started, left from Wapena Pound, up over St. Mary's for the first 17K. And I was sort of sitting in the top three over St. Mary's, and I think I was feeling really good and really in control. But in hindsight, I just went over there a little too quickly. I got to checkpoint one and I was feeling like really good and in control, but I could feel a blister coming on my pinky toe.
How you feeling?
That was tough. That last 2 kilometres.
So that was a concern. And then I left from checkpoint one in a lot of control to head to checkpoint two and checkpoint three. And from one to three, like, I felt great. My legs were good. I felt like I was putting enough food down and really in control. I was running with Jared for a lot of it. And that dude's amazing. Like, he is a savage. It's his first miler, and the fashion in which he ran in and how well he did across the whole event was just amazing. So it was epic to share some kilometres with him and some kilometres by myself and some creek beds. And I got to checkpoint three and I just felt like I should take like 10 minutes to get some food down and get on top of everything. And I think I was feeling really good and in control, but that was when I realised that maybe I wasn't running my own race a little bit.
I'm not really into it at the moment. I prefer to have someone to run with.
Jared and Simon took off and I sort of was like, well, I'm going to stay and eat some food a little bit longer and try to get all my kit together and then follow them. And I took my poles after checkpoint three and I like immediately regretted it. It was like just technical terrain. And from three to four, I had my poles. They were doing my head in. The arches of my feet started to hurt a little bit. And so my goal was just to get to checkpoint four.
Mm-hmm.
two potatoes, two baby foods, and two Snickers, and one Gerald, that's all.
You got it, you got it. Let me down.
I got there and picked up Tommy, who was buddy running with me for that whole section. And I felt good, like I got the food down, and I moved from checkpoint 4 to checkpoint 6 like really quickly. I felt really good. Me and Tom were hammering. And I think I just spent like maybe 5 minutes too long up there and like cooled down heaps. And after me and Tom left that checkpoint, I just started walking and I was like, I need a little bit of time to just warm up. And I just couldn't get back into any form after that. I was just like battling. The arches in my feet started to flare up heaps. That was the thing that got me the whole race, was from about 86K onwards, was the arches of my feet were just in agony. Like I felt like I couldn't put my foot flat or get any rhythm, because it was just like they were getting stabbed repetitively.
I see what taking the back.
So from 6 to 8, I think I took about 2 hours longer than I should have. And it was just a battle of like walking and fighting the cold and warming up and then getting cold again. And I just couldn't keep any pace and I got a bit defeated through there.
Maybe. I need a massage. I need you to look at my feet. I might have to change my socks and shoes.
Like really defeated through there. And got to 106K, got to the checkpoint and warmed up a bit. I was sitting there trying to eat some noodles and drink some Solo. And Morgan, who came in third, who's a savage, was just power chucking noodles and Solo. And it was sort of like epic. It just brought me to like of what an ultra really is. But he started vomiting and then he was just like, well, it's not gonna happen any quicker. Sitting here, and he took off, and I don't know, I sort of got a bit of inspiration out of that and got running. And from there, I was good for about 10Ks and stayed warm and had food. And then probably at about 115, I started to feel the night. It was like 2 or 3 a.m. and I really started to feel tired. And I was trekking. Probably at about 117, I was sort of walking and yawning and walking and yawning on myself, and I was just having these thoughts of like, I don't know if I can stay awake, and I was drifting off, and this guy, Daniel, ran past me and was just like my guardian angel. And he helped me a lot get through about the next 30 kilometers. Like, it's pretty like amazing thing for someone to just do that with you and to share that experience with someone. And I'm sure he was battling, but without him, there's no way I would have finished that race. I ended up getting to checkpoint 11, 144K, and it was St. Mary's, and I sort of knew I was home from there and that I was gonna finish. It was just the fashion in which I finished in. I was like sitting there, just brutalized, just like out of it, really emotional. I'd sort of spent like a couple of kilometers just like walking and crying a little bit before that. Got there, got with Tom, and tried to get up St. Mary's as quick as we could, but my feet just, it was just all my feet. They just didn't have it in them. Like everything I stepped on was just so painful. Just the arches of my feet were in agony. But we got to the top of St. Mary's with the most epic sunrise behind us. And then, we slowly made it to the finish line, and I was an absolute shell of myself, but got there. It was amazing to see all my family and friends and support crew and knock the first miler off, because it was an absolute soul-searching journey from kilometre one to kilometre 160, so that's sort of how it went. Everyone says that maybe it takes a few days or a few weeks before you decide you're going to do your next one, and I think I decided during the event that I was going to do another one. Like, I just want to take what I learned from that one, all the pacing, the food, the stops, what it does to your mind. Like, I just want to take what I learned into another one. I just want to keep building on them and building on them, because I think a few small changes would have definitely helped me with a lot of things, and I think they're just experiences that you need to go through. Like, I hadn't done any long events. I hadn't done 100K or anything like that. You know, the most I'd done was like 10 or 11 hours on my feet, and I noticed that. So I just want to put this one as like a huge learning experience and go out and do another one. Because for your first miler, I think it's all just a learning experience. Unless you're Jared. That guy's a beast. He's unbelievable. I have a problem with going out a little bit too hard, and I felt like I wasn't going out too hard, but I was in hindsight. I wouldn't spend as much time at checkpoints. It was amazing to see like all my crew at all the checkpoints, but the amazing thing about it was I just got like battled down to my core and was like just in the worst place. And it's amazing how many times you can go to a low and then pick yourself back up, and then you go to a low, and it's to get that feeling of like raw emotion where you just like cry and you just feel like you're absolutely beaten is a pretty amazing feeling, and it's what you grow from. So you have to go through those things to come out the other side a different person. So it was brutal.